All right, we're going to go to Acts chapter 13 this morning. We'll put some slides up for you so you know where the page reference is and what verses we're reading. But the 13th chapter of the book of Acts is our main text this morning. Start out just kind of setting the stage. Paul and his missionary companions are in Antioch, which you might remember was kind of the birthplace of the church. It was where believers were first called Christians. It's in Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. So that kind of sets the stage, and then we'll jump down to verse 36. But we'll begin reading in Acts 13:13. From Paphos, Paul and his companions sailed to Perga in Pamphylia, where John left them to return to Jerusalem. From Perga, they went on to Pisidian Antioch, and on the Sabbath, they entered the synagogue and sat down. After the reading from the law and the prophets, the synagogue rulers sent word to them, saying, "Brothers, if you have a message of encouragement for the people, please speak." And then he goes on, and we're not going to read all of this chapter, but let's pick up at verse 36. "For when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep. He was buried with his fathers, and his body decayed. But the one whom God raised from the dead did not see decay. Therefore, my brothers, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. Through him, everyone who believes is justified from everything you could not be justified from by the law of Moses. Take care that what the prophets have said does not happen to you. Look, you scoffers, wonder and perish, for I am going to do something in your days that you would never believe, even if someone told you." As Paul and Barnabas were leaving the synagogue, the people invited them to speak further about these things on the next Sabbath. When the congregation was dismissed, many of the Jews and devout converts to Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who talked with them and urged them to continue in the grace of God. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. When the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy and talked abusively against what Paul was saying. Then Paul and Barnabas answered them boldly, "We had to speak the word of God to you first. Since you reject it and do not consider yourselves worthy of eternal life, we now turn to the Gentiles. For this is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth." When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed for eternal life believed. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of God endures forever. Amen. Well, this might seem like a little bit of a strange passage to you for a sermon that's entitled Baptized by the Spirit, because the Holy Spirit isn't even mentioned in this text that I just read. But the Holy Spirit's hands and his activity are all over this story, and they are all over us today. If this is not a Sunday to get us thinking about the power of the Holy Spirit and the Lord's harvest, then I don't know what is. We're sending 30 people, maybe it's 31 if we count you, Tom. we're sending at least 30 people to Mississippi today. And I tell you, I believe that this is a divine marker in time for the history of this church to reach a lost world for Jesus. God is always at his work, of course, but I think we need to understand and appreciate the significance of what God is doing this morning as a very special thing in our midst. God is raising the bar. He's putting his Spirit's mission, his Spirit's calling in front of us, indeed upon us, and he's saying, "Go, go and make disciples." And I sense that God is saying, even in the words of Paul here, "Fifth Reformed Church, my people, I am going to do something in your days that you wouldn't believe even if you were told." I love that verse. It's like, Lord, you're going to astound us. You know, this is going to be incredible. It sounds in our ears this morning like something very encouraging, doesn't it? Something very promising, very hopeful, and it should. But actually, at the time that it was originally spoken, it was a word of condemnation. That's why Paul prefaced those words in verse 40 by saying, "Take care that what the prophets have said doesn't happen to you. Look, you scoffers, wonder and perish." It was a word of condemnation to them. And actually, I'd like to have us look at that text in Habakkuk. I know you know right where Habakkuk is, and you'll go immediately to that page, but just in case you don't know, the reference is up on the screen, and that's for the Pew Bible, obviously. But let's look at a couple of verses here, starting chapter 1, verse 5. Look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed, for I am going to do something in your days that you would not believe even if you were told. Okay, there's the verse that Paul quotes. What's he going to do? I'm raising up the Babylonians, that ruthless and impetuous people who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwelling places not their own. Okay, then he talks about the Babylonian army and kind of the effect that they have on people, what they do. Get down to verse 10, where we'll pick up the reading. They deride kings and scoff at rulers. They laugh at all fortified cities. They build earthen ramps and capture them. Then they sweep past like the wind and go on, guilty men whose own strength is their God. And then verse 12. O Lord, are you not from everlasting? Habakkuk is struggling with this. My God, my Holy One, we will not die. It's almost like a question and a statement. O Lord, you have appointed them to execute judgment. O Rock, you have ordained them to punish. Even though the children of Israel were the chosen people of God, he was fed up with their wickedness and their rebellion. So he raises up the Babylonians to discipline them, to kind of clean out his chosen vessel. And it was under King Nebuchadnezzar, if you remember your history at all, they defeated the Egyptians, Battle of Carchemish, in 605 BC. They wipe out the Egyptians, the biggest army in the world up to that point. On their way back to Babylon, they stop in Judah, and they ransack the temple, and they take some of the brightest and best Jews captive back to Babylon. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and others. 8 years later, Nebuchadnezzar comes back and does some more damage, takes 10,000 more people into captivity, into exile in Babylon. And then in 586 BC, Nebuchadnezzar actually comes, lays siege to Jerusalem, totally wipes out the city, burns the temple, and takes most of the rest of the survivors back to Babylon. Habakkuk, however you say this guy's name, is living through most or all of that period of God's judgment. He sees this. And the question that's burning in his belly is, God, why would you do such a thing? And you can read the first four verses of his prophecy, but the basic questioning is, Lord, why don't you help us? Lord, why don't you listen? Why don't you come and save us? Why do you tolerate this that the Babylonians are doing to us? Well, you can read the rest of Habakkuk's prophecy sometime later today or this week to get the answer. But Acts 13, actually, which we read, also has the answer to the prophet's question. Listen to verse 47 again. This is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles. Why? Why are you a light for the Gentiles? So that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. So God's purpose in saving and electing the children of Israel was to make them a light to all the other nations on earth. Friends, the church of Jesus Christ is the new Israel. We are the new Israel. Paul talks about that in Romans 9 to 11, Ephesians 2 and 3, other places in the New Testament. We're the new Israel, and just like the first Israel, God's purpose in saving us is to be a light to the nations, to bring his salvation to other people. So to the extent that we do that faithfully and do that well, we will be a true church. But if we fail, God could potentially send his discipline and his judgment upon us, just like he did the first Israel. Why would he not, if we're not fulfilling his decree and his purposes for us? I want you to notice verse 36. It says again, for when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep. Now that doesn't mean like he went to bed. It means he died. And he was buried with his fathers. They don't usually bury people who just fall asleep, but he died. Most of us know that David was a great man of God. I mean, he was a spiritual giant, right? Killed Goliath. He was a type of the kingship of Christ. You know, he's the messianic line came from David. He was a man after God's own heart, Scripture says. So he did a lot of great things. But look at what this says. David only lived as long as he served the purpose of God for his life and his generation. He only lived as long as he served the purpose of God. Do you know that that is true for every single one of us? God will only give you life as long as you somehow serve his purposes. So if this morning you're living and breathing, that's really good news, because that means God has a purpose for your life. That's really good news. You might wonder, well, what is my purpose? You know, especially if you're a young person, you're thinking, you know, I can't figure out what my purpose in life is. Well, look at verse 38 again. He says, therefore, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. Paul, the apostle, understood that the purpose of his life was to proclaim that Jesus forgives sins. Do you know what? That's the purpose of my life as a pastor. But guess what? It's the purpose of your life if you believe in Jesus. That's the purpose of your existence. Now, if you're not a believer in Jesus today, the only reason that you are still alive is because God wants to bring you to a relationship with Christ. He's giving you time so that you can come to Christ. And then your purpose is to proclaim the forgiveness of Jesus to other people. And if you want to know how to do that, there's a prayer in towards the back of our bulletin this morning, Want to Know Christ. It explains how to do that. It's a simple thing, so easy a child could do it. But when I get back from Mississippi, if you want to talk to me about that, I would love to talk to you about that. I'm all over that. God is pushing us beyond our comfort zones. He's pulling us into mission, especially those of us wearing this really awesome blue shirt that Darren designed for us. He's zealous to see people saved. And you know what? That needs to be on our hearts this week. Be zealous to see people saved. A couple of months ago, we were on vacation. I went out to see our daughter Joy in New Mexico, went up to Durango, Colorado, and we were in that area. We were on a state highway, and we were at a stoplight, and the guy ahead of us, his car dies, and he's not going anywhere. So the guy behind me jumps out, I jump out, we push this guy's off the road. I mean, people are whizzing past us at 45 miles an hour. And it reminded me of an occasion back in Allendale where the same thing happened. A guy's car died right on M45, and me and another guy pushed this guy's car for at least a city block. And I got to tell you, when I was done with that, I was whooped. Man, I was one tired puppy. It taxed all of my physical resources. But what's interesting, you know, I said to this guy, do you want me to call a tow truck for you? I mean, you want me to go get some tools? Or, I mean, how can I help? And he said, no problem. You know, I got a cell phone. I'll call. I'll take care of it. He says, you know, really, this isn't a big deal for me. This happens all the time. I'm kind of used to it. And I thought, you know, why would you keep a car that dies on you all the time, right in the middle of the road? I mean, maybe if you had a classic, you know, an antique vehicle and it died on rare occasions, you'd keep it or something. But, you know, how much would a car like that be worth to you? I mean, how much pleasure would a car like that bring to you? And I got thinking about that, and I thought, you know, God doesn't find any more pleasure in pushing people to do the Great Commandment or the Great Commission than we would find in pushing a car down the road that dies on us all the time. God wants men and women of great ambition, of great initiative, of great motivation, of spiritual fervor. It's a good biblical term, comes from Romans 12, 11. We'll put the words up on the screen. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. Good verse. Why should you do that? Because you're serving the Lord. An interesting way to take that verse is, as you serve the Lord, you will stir up your spiritual fervor and your zeal. I'm hoping that's what happens to me and to all of us wearing the shirts as we go south this week. It's going to stir up our spiritual fervor. Now, a person who has to constantly be pushed or pulled in order to keep them coming to church, keep them serving God or witnessing for Christ, I would say they are not very devoted to the cause of Christ. Plain and simple. I mean, that's my honest take on it. And I know because I have been one of those people many years of my own walk with the Lord. Now, that's understandable if you're a newborn babe in Christ, if you're a new convert. You know, sometimes they need to be pushed with a little bit of encouragement because they just don't quite understand everything yet. But for someone who has been a professing follower of Jesus for many years or most of their life, and they don't do the will of God, and they don't follow the commands of God, and they don't witness for Christ any way, shape, or form, what does God think about that? I think we know. It's pretty clear. So my question to myself and my question to all of us this morning is, do you have to be pushed? Now, I don't know if Grandpa and Grandma encouraged some of you guys to go on this trip or a friend or whatever. You know, maybe God nudged you through somebody else, and that's great. But when it comes to our daily walk with Christ, how much do we need to be pushed to do what's right there in black and white? I'm not trying to beat anybody up this morning. I'm not trying to lay a huge guilt trip on you, because we struggle. This is normal. But you know what? We need to walk with the Lord. Eugene Peterson translates that verse in Romans 12 in the Message. He says it this way: don't burn out. Keep yourselves fueled and aflame. Be alert servants of the Master. Be cheerfully expectant. And I love that language. Cheerfully expectant of what? Is the question. Well, for God to do something in your life that you wouldn't believe, even if you were told, that's what. For people to actually come into a saving relationship with Christ because of you, that's what. For people to be delivered from the damnation and the torture of hell because of you, that's what. For people to be healed of disease and delivered of demons and forgiven of their sins because of you? Wow. Paul says in verse 48 of our text, when the Gentiles heard this news, the gospel, he means, they were glad, yeah, and they honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed for eternal life believed. Now think about what that's saying. God had chosen, in other words, he had predestined, it's a good Reformed term, biblical term, some of those people in the crowd that day to become Christians, but they would not come to faith. They would not become believers unless and until they heard the message. And you know what? God still works in the same way, folks. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing comes by the word of Christ. You've got to get the message from somebody. And we're going to do that this week. God has appointed people to believe, but he's counting on us to declare the message to them. He says, I have made you, a light to the nations, so that you may bring salvation to the earth. Now, you might say, well, did God really mean you, me, that we bring salvation to the earth? Yes. Yes, he did. And I don't know about you, but that just totally humbles me. Totally humbles me. Motivates me, for sure. And you know what else? It also should define me. It should define the kind of person I am and what I do with my time. Brothers and sisters, it's time. It's time for all of us to be what we really are, and that is the light of the world. You know, I'm not saying that you're not now. I don't know. God knows that. It's not my place to judge that. But I just believe that it's time for us to do more than we've ever done, passionately, to be the light of the world. The 30 of us going to Mississippi, we're gonna give that a good shot this week, to be the light of the world. Let me tell you a little story. Max Beerbohm is an author. He wrote a story called The Happy Hypocrite, which is kind of an ironic title, isn't it, for a story? But anyway, that's what it was called. The story was about a character whose face was so ugly and it was so mean-looking that it almost personified evil. And the man was faced with a dilemma, pun intended. He was in love with a beautiful woman, And she liked him in many ways, but she just couldn't bring herself to marry this guy because he was just horrifically ugly. You know, I mean, he was just one of those guys that she didn't want to be seen in public with. So the guy decides that he's going to get one of these realistic human masks, you know, like they use on TV, that you have to peel it off like glue or whatever. So he got one of those with a face of someone who was really kind and adoring and gentle and wise and, you know, all that good stuff. I mean, one of those beautiful faces. So she decides to marry him as long as he keeps the mask on. So over time, this husband proves to be even more the man that this woman dreamed of having for a husband. I mean, he'd listen to her. Hear me, guys. He'd listen to her. He doted on her. I mean, he just poured out his love sacrificially and unconditionally for this woman. And he was a phenomenal husband. Well, one day he's at work and he gets into an argument with this guy and they start fighting. And they worked in the same place and this guy grabs his face and actually, you know, like scratches him, and guess what comes off? The mask. And she's right there and she sees that. And guess what's underneath? It's no longer this ugly, sinister, grotesque face. It is a beautiful, tender, loving, wise face. He had become the things that he was living out in his relationship to her. And do you know it's that way for us as believers? When we come to Christ, we put on Christ. We take on his face. We take on his mind, his attitude, his voice, his heart. Our evil and our ugly sinful nature is still there, sure enough. It will be till the day we die. But the Bible says that that nature is being transformed. It's being renewed day by day. We're changing. We should be changing. You know, we don't do the old things that were, you know, contrary to the Spirit and part of the sinful flesh. We don't do those things anymore. Read 1 John 3, 1 to 10, and you'll know what I'm talking about. So that's getting smaller, it's getting weaker, and what's coming up in us is the grace and the knowledge of Christ, and it's the sanctification of the Holy Spirit. It's more of the person of the Holy Spirit showing through us. It's amazing. I want to have us read a couple of verses in Philippians. If you want to turn to your Bibles to Philippians chapter 2. Coming to a close here pretty quick. Listen to these words in Philippians 2, 12 and 13. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And now listen to this, for it is God who works in you. It is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. And just think about what Paul is saying there. God himself, Almighty God, Creator God, Sovereign God, is in you. He's at work in you to fulfill his purposes. And as I said last week, that's what the baptism of the Holy Spirit is all about. It is Christ in us. Paul says in Colossians 1:27, Christ in you is the hope of glory. Now, glory means literally the manifest presence and power of God, which means that literally the manifest presence of God to other people who meet us and know us will be shown as they see Jesus, as they see Jesus. And what I think that means is that you don't really need another prayer, you don't need another conference, you don't need another meeting, you don't need another training, you don't need another Christian book, you don't need another anointing. You just need to know you have Jesus. And you need to let the Spirit of Jesus completely dominate and just have his way with you. You just, I surrender all, like we just sang, I surrender all to you. We step out in faith and let the Spirit be in control. And when we do that, it's amazing because then we don't have to try to trump God with our natural abilities and talents. We can just relax and let the Holy Spirit do his witnessing and his serving and his, you know, all that good stuff through us. It really takes a lot of the burden off of us, not the responsibility, but the burden of it or the fear. So I think we underestimate this power that God has put into us. I mean, it is truly amazing, and that's why Paul prays for that with the Ephesians. Let's just look quickly at Ephesians 1, 18 to 20. And I tried to put this on the blog, Danielle, last night, because I wanted this prayer to be something that everyone could get before the trip. So I just decided to work it into the message. But you'll have to show me how to post to the blog. Listen to this. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he's called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and now this, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is like the working of his mighty strength, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms. Do you mean to tell me that the very same Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead on Easter Sunday morning is the Spirit in me? That's what I'm telling you. That's what I'm telling you. Can you believe that? Whoa! That's humbling and motivating too, isn't it? But what that means is that if you're a believer in Jesus, you already have within you what it takes to bring relief and hope and comfort and the gospel to people who need to know it. You have Jesus when you offer yourself. And I like what Kay Warren says in her book, Dangerous Surrender. In and of myself, I don't have much to offer another person. But when I bring Jesus, I bring the one thing they need the most. Amen. I love that. Here's our Christian mandate. This isn't my words. Somebody came up with this, but we'll put it on the screen. It's pretty good. Go and do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, to all the people you can, for as long as you can. You know, we got to get out there. We got to get out there. We can't stay in the comfort of our nest here at the church. And some of you probably know this if you have studied birds, and especially bald eagles or golden eagles, you know how this works. Eagles have a nest that's called an eyrie, kind of a strange name, but they're built of sticks, obviously. They're huge most of the time. And when they're about to have their babies, they'll actually pluck fresh green leaves off the tree and line the nest with that so it's soft for the baby eagles. About once a year, the female lays one or two eggs, and they're carefully tended, sometimes even by the male eagle, until they hatch in about a month and a half. Both of the parents, after they're born, guard the nest and bring food to the little eaglets. And then at about 11 or 12 weeks, if they haven't ventured out on their own yet, one of the parents, typically the male, will start to stir the nest, rock the nest, even tip the nest, so that these little eagles don't have any choice except to get out and fly. And then what they do is they watch them. They carefully monitor them as they're flapping and, you know, trying to figure out this business of flying, so that if they're at that critical moment of failure, then they swoop down underneath them and they land on their back and they bring them back up to the nest. And then they'll try it again later. But it's an amazing thing to watch. And it's something that makes me think about the need for a lot of us to be tipped out of the nest of the church. And, you know, we sometimes don't figure out that business of flying until we're really flapping and whatever in the church. But, you know, it's very clear to me, go ahead and put the slide up, Aaron, that God wants us to fly, folks. He wants us to fly. He doesn't want us fluttering and flopping around and spoon-feeding in the church. No, he wants us to get out there and rock the world for Christ. I mean, just be about it. Get your hands dirty. Get into the game. Go for it. Don't be afraid. God is with you. What can mere man do to you? Kill you? Then you go to heaven. You win. You know? I mean, we just got to get out and do it. And that's why I'm so pumped about this trip. I mean, I haven't done a thing like this in a long time. Man, it's hot up here. But I got to wrap this up because our time is gone. We got to eat lunch and go. So let me close with these words. Isaiah 40, even youth grow tired and weary. Get ready for that, you guys. Youths grow tired and weary. Young men stumble and fall. Got your back. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. Praise the Lord. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. So that's God's promise to us today. That's a great word of encouragement for us. But it's for all of us. It's God's promise to you. Get out there and soar like an eagle, because you know what? The mission field just isn't Port Gibson, Mississippi. It's Muskegon. It's Whitehall. It's Twin Lake. It's Fruitport. It's right outside those doors. We need God in a big way, don't we? So let's pray together. Praise team, you can come on up. Lord, we just bless you and praise you for your call upon us. Lord, this is kind of a hard word, but it's a word that we need, Lord, because we allow ourselves to get so caught up in the world, so busy, so encultured with all the stuff going on in our world, and none of it satisfies, Lord. Only you satisfy. And so, Lord Jesus, we want to serve you with heart and soul and mind and strength. We want to show that we love you, Lord, by serving, by introducing people to your son, Jesus, who's the best thing that ever happened to any of us. And Lord, we want to just demonstrate the love of Christ in every way that we can think of. So Lord, energize us for that. Motivate us, Lord. Give us ambition beyond ambition and passion beyond passion to be the hands and feet of Christ to a watching, waiting, dying world. Lord, please don't let anybody that we know go to hell because we didn't share Christ with them. Make us bold and courageous, people who do not fear. Lord, equip us by your Spirit. Baptize us with the power of your Holy Spirit to do this that you've called us to do, because we can't do it without you. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.